Dizer que é uma grande alegria estar aqui nesse dia hoje, realizando para nós um sonho de botar essas pessoas todas que trabalham pela segurança do paciente juntas, como a gente sempre desejou, trabalhar em comunidade, né? Vocês sabem que o segundo anuário da Segurança Hospitalar Brasileira de 2018, ele faz uma estimativa de que mais de 230 mil brasileiros morrem anualmente em função dos eventos adversos nos hospitais brasileiros. Internacionalmente, vocês vão ver a apresentação da Ariana, do Marte. A Patient Safety Movement estima que em todo o mundo, em torno de 4,8 milhões de pessoas morrem anualmente por eventos potencialmente evitáveis. A Organização Mundial da Saúde definiu como segurança do paciente a redução dos riscos de danos desnecessários associados à assistência em saúde até um mínimo aceitável. E com o objetivo de estabelecer ações práticas para lidar com esse tema tão urgente e relevante, a OMS aprovou recentemente o Plano Global para a Segurança do Paciente 2021-2030, visando eliminar danos evitáveis aos pacientes durante a sua assistência em saúde. Nós acreditamos que a tão falada disrupção do mercado da saúde passa necessariamente pela revisão dos nossos processos assistenciais, com o foco em trabalho em equipe, priorizando a segurança do paciente como um dos pilares essenciais. Nós, da Safety for Me, desde a nossa fundação, nos comprometemos a criar uma grande comunidade em torno do tema, trabalhando com a missão de ouvir os pacientes para transformar o cuidado. Nosso propósito, segurança do paciente, é o que nos movimenta. E temos muito orgulho de recebê-los a todos vocês para a nossa primeira Semana Internacional de Segurança do Paciente da Safety for Me.
Nosso especial agradecimento ao nosso patrocinador, Sandoz do Brasil, e eu gostaria de pedir a atenção de todos para um vídeo preparado especialmente para a nossa semana.
Com 20 anos de experiência, os medicamentos biosimilares da Sandoz estão em 100 países. E tem mais de 530 milhões de pacientes. Todas essas pessoas formam uma rede que depende da eficiência e confiança nos nossos produtos. Se preocupar com a segurança de um paciente é cuidar para que ele também se sinta seguro. E para reafirmar o controle de qualidade dos nossos produtos, contamos com a farmacovigilância de forma contínua. Isso significa detectar, avaliar, compreender e prevenir eventos adversos com os medicamentos. Nosso plano de gerenciamento de risco descreve a rotina de farmacovigilância e outras ações de segurança. A Sandoz está presente nesse compromisso com um claro objetivo: prolongar a vida do paciente com qualidade e segurança. O paciente seguro é aquele que pode confiar no seu tratamento.
Gostaríamos também de agradecer o apoio da UNA e da Patient Centricity Consulting para a realização dessa semana, que está sendo muito especial. Para darmos início, então, à nossa Semana Internacional da Segurança do Paciente Safety for Me, eu gostaria de dar as boas-vindas à Cassiana Prates, doutora em enfermagem, gerente de riscos no Hospital Ernesto Dornelles, uma grande parceira da Safety for Me desde o início. Para nós é uma honra te ter aqui, Cassi, e passo a palavra para que tu possa nos ajudar a compreender o case do Hospital Ernesto Dornelles no engajamento do paciente na sua segurança. Por favor.
Tá, muito obrigada, Carol, pelas palavras. Eu vou inicialmente compartilhar minha tela. Bom, gostaria de inicialmente agradecer esse convite da Carol e do Salvador de estar fazendo parte, então, dessa Semana Internacional da Segurança do Paciente e dizer que nesse momento meu sentimento não é outro que não felicidade. É um sorriso de orelha a orelha de ver essa semana realmente sendo um sucesso, mais de 1.200 pessoas inscritas, Então, realmente, isso comprova, né, o quanto esse assunto é necessário, né, o quanto as pessoas buscam por esclarecimento sobre segurança do paciente. E é ótimo, então, estar aqui podendo falar um pouquinho sobre o case do Hospital Ernesto Dornelles com o Safety for Me. E, na verdade, o nosso case ele inicia anterior ao Safety for Me, né, quando o aplicativo ainda era denominado Dr. Rafael. Eu lembro exatamente do dia em que o Salvador me encaminhou um vídeo. Eu estava indo para a praia nesse dia e o Salvador me encaminhou o vídeo do aplicativo e disse assim: dá uma olhada e vê o que que tu acha. E eu olhei aquele vídeo, né, que tinha um propósito de educar pacientes para a segurança do paciente e me chamou realmente a atenção. Um médico super famoso, né, diretor da PUC, superintendente da Unimed. E totalmente engajado nas questões da segurança do paciente. E na sequência ele me apresenta a Carol, né, que vem complementar todo esse propósito que eles têm de transformar realmente a vida dos pacientes, educando-os para a segurança do paciente. E foi nessas duas pessoas que eu vi realmente um interesse genuíno em disseminar isso no mundo inteiro, Salvador. Eu acho que dá para a gente dizer hoje em dia, porque o crescimento é exponencial, do que vocês vêm, fazendo ao longo desses anos. Então, eu enxergo no Safety for Me, realmente um time multidisciplinar. Um time engajado nas questões de segurança do paciente e que realmente aplica uma missão de ouvir os pacientes e transformar o cuidado. Então, para nós do Hospital Ernesto Dornelles, é extremamente gratificante estar aqui apresentando um pouquinho dessa nossa parceria. O Hospital Ernesto Dornelles, aqui em Porto Alegre, é um hospital que recentemente foi acreditado pleno pela Organização Nacional de Acreditação. É um hospital grande em Porto Alegre, um hospital privado, que tem mais de 300 leitos de internação e 40 deles leitos de terapia intensiva, um centro cirúrgico que realiza mais de 1.200 cirurgias por mês, uma emergência grande com 5 mil atendimentos mês. Enfim, uma organização que vocês devem imaginar o quão difícil é implantar e consolidar uma cultura de segurança do paciente. Pois nesse hospital, lá em 2018, abriu as suas portas para que a gente pudesse fazer, se é que eu posso chamar desse jeito, Carol, depois tu me corrige se eu estiver errado, uma incubadora do aplicativo. Eu estava fazendo essa apresentação e lembrando do dia que os meninos da TI foram até o hospital e presenciaram os pacientes internados, jogando, né, mexendo no aplicativo para realmente entender como isso se dava na prática. Essa abertura do hospital, né, foi graças ao apoio que a gente teve das superintendências do hospital, na pessoa do senhor Odacir e do Dr. Ricardo Guterres, que realmente acreditaram nesse projeto, né, e nos apoiaram desde o início. O Hospital Ernesto Dornelles, ele declara o compromisso com a segurança do paciente, colocando a cultura da segurança do paciente como um objetivo estratégico dentro de uma perspectiva no seu plano estratégico. E essas ações de segurança do paciente, elas estão contidas em uma política institucional. Então, a nossa política de segurança do paciente, ela ocupa o mesmo patamar das demais políticas institucionais e define ações claras a serem desenvolvidas no hospital, pensando na segurança do paciente, desde a consolidação de uma cultura, na promoção de ações de melhorias, no gerenciamento de processos de trabalho de recursos humanos voltados para a segurança do paciente, no desenvolvimento de capacitação, no estímulo à notificação dos eventos e, obviamente, no envolvimento do paciente e da sua família no seu cuidado. Toda essa política de segurança, ela é traduzida para o nosso corpo funcional a partir de estratégias de segurança. Então, todas as ações que nós desenvolvemos no hospital, elas estão vinculadas a uma dessas nove estratégias que temos na instituição. E o Safety for Me, ele se encontra nessa estratégia número 9, que é o paciente pela sua segurança. Importante salientar que essa foi uma estratégia que ela não surgiu no início, quando criamos essas estratégias de segurança. Ela surge em 2018 na nossa instituição, depois já de longos 10 anos discutindo segurança do paciente. E esse é um caminho comum, né? A gente precisa de uma cultura mínima estabelecida dentro da instituição para poder envolver o paciente no seu cuidado. Então, em 2018, nós discutimos e achamos que já estávamos num momento em que poderíamos envolver o paciente na sua segurança, pois já tínhamos uma série de outras atividades relacionadas à segurança do paciente já bem implantadas em desenvolvimento do hospital. A operação de todo esse trabalho se faz por meio do Serviço de Epidemiologia e Gerenciamento de Riscos do nosso hospital. É o serviço, então, que operacionaliza todas as ações relacionadas à segurança do paciente. Criado em 2009, hoje conta com 3 profissionais, né? Eu que faço a coordenação como enfermeira, a Melissa, coordenadora do grupo de quedas e enfermeira também, e a Lise, nossa estagiária e a expert, então, no aplicativo e que faz com que esse aplicativo seja desenvolvido, então, na nossa instituição, apresentando aos nossos pacientes. O CGER é um serviço, então, que tem 3 pessoas. Mas eu me recordo num determinado momento que o doutor Ricardo me chamou na sala dele, o nosso superintendente, e me disse uma frase que ficou marcada para mim e que eu procuro levar sempre. Cassi, o CEGER não é tu, o CEGER somos todos nós. E é com esse sentimento de união, né, de realmente um grupo multidisciplinar que a gente leva as ações de segurança do paciente na nossa instituição. Então, são essas pessoas que no seu dia a dia de trabalho implementam as ações que a gente pensa, que a gente discute e que a gente estimula na nossa instituição. E aí a gente tinha um grande desafio, né, que era implantar então esse game, esse app, numa instituição onde a gente tem uma prevalência alta de pacientes idosos, né, que muitas vezes não tem uma facilidade de mexer aí em aplicativos, e aí como é que a gente ia desenvolver tudo isso? Hoje a gente tem um jeito muito claro, né, um modo de fazer, um modo de aplicar o aplicativo, desde 2020. Então, como que a gente desenvolve isso no hospital? A gente realizou um teste piloto em 2 unidades de internação em 2020. Vejam vocês que a gente estava no início da pandemia aqui, né? Então, nesse momento mesmo, a gente resolveu aplicar esse teste piloto em 2 unidades de internação, com o apoio da coordenação de enfermagem dessas 2 áreas. Na sequência, a gente, junto com a Carol, que nos ajudou, aplicamos um questionário para a equipe assistencial para identificar o conhecimento que eles tinham acerca das ações de segurança do paciente. E, a partir daí, nós definimos quais seriam os pacientes elegíveis, então, para que pudéssemos realizar as visitas de apresentação do aplicativo. Então, hoje é assim que funciona no nosso hospital. Hoje a gente já expandiu, isso está em todas as unidades de internação do nosso hospital. Acontece uma visita 1, então, pela nossa estagiária Lise, onde ela apresenta um folder de orientação do que é o aplicativo, ela faz uma breve explicação do que são as metas de segurança para os pacientes e estimula, então, o paciente a fazer o download do aplicativo e auxilia, no caso, se for necessário, se o paciente solicitar ajuda. Na sequência, a gente tem uma visita 2, né? Então, 24 horas depois dessa primeira visita, a gente volta no quarto desse paciente, identifica se esse paciente baixou o aplicativo ou não, esclarece as dúvidas e ainda auxilia se for o caso. E a gente, dentro do nosso método, ainda tem uma visita 3, que é uma visita próximo à alta desse paciente, que é justamente para a gente estimular, então, que o paciente tenha baixado o aplicativo e estimular que ele faça, então, a avaliação, as avaliações, né, e a avaliação de alta para que a gente tenha aí o questionário de experiência do paciente. Importante dizer que em 2020 isso ficou bastante claro, né? A gente definiu esse método de trabalho. Mas anterior a 2020, lá em 2018, em 2019, a gente começou com todo o movimento de disseminar isso na nossa instituição. Então, uma das coisas que a gente tem é um fórum mensal de discussão, que ele acontece sempre na última quarta-feira do mês, e vejam vocês que o doutor Rafael, aqui na época, né, então Salvador, participou dessa reunião representando a voz dos pacientes. É uma reunião em que a gente discute um caso de evento grave, de evento sentinela, que tem acontecido na nossa instituição, disseminando, então, uma cultura de segurança. Então, aqui a gente começa a disseminar a importância do envolvimento do paciente e da sua família para as ações de segurança do paciente. E em 2020, então, a gente consegue operacionalizar tudo isso e definir um método de trabalho. Ainda nós temos orgulho de termos contribuído, então, para a criação da trilha de hemodiálise, né, a doutora Cíntia e eu, junto com toda a equipe do Safety for Me, criando, então, essa trilha da diálise. Com relação aos nossos resultados, né, eu quero dizer inicialmente que o aplicativo é muito mais do que um jogo, né? O aplicativo, ele realmente agrega valor na assistência aos nossos pacientes. E isso a gente precisa enxergar, né? A partir da medição, então, da percepção do paciente sobre as metas de segurança, o paciente, depois de uma educação com relação a cada uma das metas, ele é convidado a fazer uma avaliação e pontua de 0 a 10, então, a sua satisfação ou como ele percebe que essa meta é trabalhada dentro da organização. A partir dessa avaliação, dessa pontuação, é calculado, então, o NPS da segurança, né? E todo paciente que entra no nosso, nesse aplicativo e digita ali que ele está no Hospital Ernesto Dornelles, ele já consegue identificar qual é o NPS da segurança na nossa instituição, que hoje está em 47%. 47% significa que nós estamos numa zona de aperfeiçoamento. Esse score ele varia de menos 100 a 100, sendo que de menos 100 a 0 é uma zona crítica, de 0 a 50 uma zona de aperfeiçoamento, de 50 a 75 estaríamos na zona de qualidade e acima de 75% na zona de excelência. Embora no NPS geral estejamos em 47%, e aqui eu não defini nenhum período, né, desde que iniciou esse trabalho na nossa instituição, embora, né, o geral seja 47%, vejam vocês que na comparação do trimestre atual para o trimestre anterior, a gente avançou aí alguns pontos e estando apenas um ponto percentual de atingirmos a zona de qualidade no NPS geral da nossa instituição. Quando a gente estratifica por metas de segurança do paciente, a gente vê que na meta de identificação a gente está numa zona de qualidade, então 58%. Na comunicação entre as equipes, 39%, isso não surpreende, a gente sabe que comunicação é uma meta difícil de ser trabalhada e problemas de comunicação são prevalentes nas nossas instituições, e segurança do paciente, um NPS de 47%, também numa zona de aperfeiçoamento. Eu acho fantástico essas comparações, né, na última atualização aí desse dashboard, porque ele traz uma comparação do trimestre atual com o trimestre anterior. E vejam vocês que no último trimestre aqui, na identificação do paciente, nós já atingimos aí uma zona de excelência para a meta de identificação correta. Comunicação efetiva, ela ainda permanece numa zona qualidade, né? Embora no geral estejamos na zona de aperfeiçoamento, mas se a gente pega o trimestre aqui, a gente já atinge uma zona de qualidade, e segurança relacionada aos medicamentos também no último trimestre numa zona de qualidade, mas se a gente compara com o trimestre anterior, a gente vê que a gente piorou um pouquinho nesse quesito. Com relação à cirurgia segura, a gente está numa zona de qualidade com 53%, higienização de mãos, zona de aperfeiçoamento, e quedas, uma zona de aperfeiçoamento também. E na comparação, a gente vê que embora na cirurgia segura a gente ainda permaneça na zona de qualidade, a gente tem uma melhora aí na comparação entre os trimestres. Higienização de mãos um pouquinho pior, né? E na prevenção de quedas no último trimestre aí, Melissa, a gente atinge a zona de excelência com 100% do NPS. Então, na verdade, eu enxergo esse dashboard, essa oportunidade que a gente tem de identificar a percepção dos pacientes com relação à meta, né? As metas de segurança, como a pecinha que faltava dentro do quebra-cabeça da gestão dos indicadores dentro de uma organização. A gente faz muito, né, o acompanhamento, as instituições têm os seus indicadores de desfecho, os seus indicadores de processo, mas a gente falha na visão do paciente, o quanto o paciente percebe, né, essa qualidade de cuidado. E aí, quando a gente vai fazer essa junção toda, né, eu acho que isso que é o bacana, esse que é o aprendizado, se a gente pega a percepção do paciente para quedas, por exemplo, que a taxa geral aqui, o NPS, é 36%. Relembrando, a gente melhorou no último trimestre, mas no geral a gente está em 36%. Eu comparo isso com o indicador gerenciado que eu tenho na minha instituição. E aí eu tenho uma taxa de quedas que é uma taxa super aceitável. A gente tem menos de 2 quedas a cada 1.000 paciente dia e vem melhorando esse indicador ao longo dos anos. Vejam que 2021, na nossa média geral, a gente está com 1,4. Já fomos 2 lá em 2018. A nossa taxa de quedas com dano, menos de 1 queda a cada 1.000 paciente dia com dano ao paciente. E aí a gente começa a se perguntar, bom, se eu tenho bons indicadores de desfecho, por que o paciente não percebe bem essas ações que a gente faz com relação às quedas? E aí a gente vai para uma outra metodologia, que é a vigilância de processos, e identifica que na maioria das vezes o paciente não recebia o folder de prevenção de quedas, e talvez por isso ele não consiga enxergar as medidas que são realizadas dentro da instituição. Se muda essa rotina e a gente melhora o nosso indicador. Então, essa é a pecinha que, na minha visão, vem a contribuir muito para a melhoria no gerenciamento dos indicadores hospitalares. Da mesma forma, higienização de mãos é a medida mais importante para prevenir as infecções. Por que o paciente não percebe isso? Será que os profissionais não higienizam as suas mãos todas as vezes que deveriam? Quando a gente vai para o nosso indicador, a gente vê que, bom, realmente tem oportunidade de melhorias. A gente reduziu um pouco a adesão à higienização de mãos. E isso faz com que o controle de infecção possa tomar uma decisão assertiva e desenvolver ações focadas, então, na melhor adesão à higienização de mãos. Já no serviço de diálise, né, a gente percebe que todas as metas ela atingem a zona de excelência, ou seja, o NPS para 6 metas de segurança aqui é acima de 75%. E vejam vocês que mesmo na zona de excelência, o score mais baixo é a segurança dos medicamentos, comprovando aquilo que a gente já sabe também, né? É uma das metas mais difíceis de serem implementadas dentro das organizações. Ainda, o aplicativo oportuniza que o paciente tenha um link com a gente, que o paciente possa, a partir do fale com a equipe, expor, né, as suas demandas e, em tempo real, a gente recebe essas notificações. De abril de 2020 a setembro de 2021, nós tivemos 82 notificações de pacientes. Dessas, a maioria são críticas, né, mas tem aí um percentual de elogios, e 33% dessas notificações têm alguma relação direta com a segurança do paciente, ou seja, são oportunidades que a gente tem de melhorar, então, a segurança do nosso paciente. Para cada relato de paciente tem um método de gerenciamento dessa informação, então a gente dá um retorno para esse paciente, para a família, esse relato é encaminhado para a ciência dos coordenadores de área e conforme a reclamação ela é encaminhada para a nossa ouvidoria, para as ações corretivas, tratativas e as ações de melhoria. E ainda esses relatos dos pacientes compõem o nosso monitoramento de dados. No nosso sistema de gerenciamento de incidentes que a gente tem na instituição, os relatos do Safety for Me, eles são incorporados e contabilizados na nossa matriz de incidente. Ou seja, se o paciente notifica um erro de medicação, um atraso na sua medicação, que ele está sem pulseira de identificação, por exemplo, esse relato do paciente é contabilizado como um incidente dentro da nossa matriz de gerenciamento. Completamos um ano em maio de 2021 e tivemos a oportunidade de escrever esse nosso relato que está disponível no site do Safety for Me, se alguém tiver interesse de acompanhar, então, como realmente foi feito, né, a implantação, quais foram os nossos aprendizados e as contribuições para o fortalecimento da cultura da segurança, está lá disponível no blog do Safety for Me. Eu seria, não seria eu se dissesse que o caminho foi fácil até aqui. Não foi, né? A gente tem muitas dificuldades para construir uma cultura de segurança dentro das nossas organizações. E se o conselho fosse bom, ninguém dava, né? Mas esses da árvore aqui vale a pena. Mas se eu pudesse deixar algumas dicas, né, do que eu entendo como requisitos necessários para o sucesso da implantação do aplicativo, eu diria que a construção de uma cultura de segurança do paciente é um requisito mínimo. Jamais, ou vai ser um tiro no pé se a gente implantar uma avaliação para o paciente e a equipe não estiver envolvida nas ações de segurança do paciente. O paciente vai começar a questionar, o paciente começa a participar do seu cuidado e a equipe não vai saber o que fazer. Então, uma cultura de segurança em construção é um requisito para o sucesso na implantação do aplicativo. O apoio da alta direção e o envolvimento das lideranças da mesma forma, né? A cultura se dissemina top-down, é de cima para baixo. Então, a gente precisa ver um comportamento e um envolvimento da liderança e da alta direção para as ações de segurança do paciente, para que eu, como profissional da linha de frente, contribua nesse processo. É importante estabelecer um método de trabalho, um plano de implantação, saber que isso não é da noite para o dia, não é de um mês para outro que a gente muda a cultura dentro das instituições, e obviamente ter uma estrutura de tecnologia e alguém para fazer isso. Se alguém disser que implantar ações de qualidade de segurança são fáceis e são baratas, está mentindo. É difícil a gente implantar e custa desenvolver ações de segurança, mas certamente o valor agregado a tudo isso supera qualquer custo. Dessa forma, eu encerro a minha participação, mais uma vez agradecendo a ti, Carol, e ao Salvador, pela oportunidade de representar o Hospital Ernesto Dornelles nessa Semana da Segurança do Paciente.
Cássia, é sempre muito bom te ouvir. Muito obrigada pelo teu relato. Entrou uma pergunta aqui no nosso chat e eu queria repassar para ti. Que é como que tu percebe ou como que foi a aceitação dos pacientes no uso do aplicativo e na contribuição das respostas assim ao longo do trabalho? Se tu puder compartilhar um pouquinho a tua visão.
Tá. Os pacientes adoram, na verdade. Os pacientes enxergam o aplicativo. Eu acho como mais uma forma de participar e de se sentirem ouvidos, né? E mais do que isso, Carol, eu acho que quando a gente dá o retorno, né? Ou quando a gente vai lá, que ele percebe que, bom, realmente eu coloquei ali e alguém veio me dizer alguma coisa, ou eu recebi um retorno, né? Então, eu acho que os pacientes enxergam muito valor nisso. É, tem confiança. Eu acho que a questão da confiança é outro aspecto importante também. Eles sabem, por exemplo, que se não quiser se identificar, ninguém vai expor esse paciente. Eu acho que isso é um ponto importante também. Por vezes o paciente pode se sentir amedrontado, né? Então, assim, ah, eu não quero falar, eu não quero sinalizar que o atendimento não está bom, por exemplo, porque depois isso pode ser pior. Então, acho que os pacientes sentem essa confiança, né? Mas mais do que isso é realmente sentir que alguém está fazendo alguma coisa pela segurança deles. Eu acho que é um aspecto importante. E outra é a equipe, né? Então, quando a gente tem uma equipe que estimula isso, né? Profissionais da enfermagem, especialmente, que estimulam o paciente, a relação ainda fica melhor, né?
Eu fui te ouvindo e fui pensando o seguinte: como é importante ter visão sistêmica e conexão entre os indicadores,
Muito.
e essa coisa da junção dos esforços de todos, né? Tanto da direção, dos colaboradores e de uma área de gestão de riscos que coloca o paciente no centro do cuidado, né? Como isso é importante. Eu queria terminar a tua palestra com uma frase tua que tu escreveu lá para o blog da Safety for Me. Se tu me permite, eu vou te parafrasear aqui. A Cássia disse o seguinte, gente, lá no nosso blog da Safety for Me: a cultura se fortalece com transparência, com aprendizado e com justiça. Eu acho que isso resume bem a palestra da Cassiana. E eu quero te agradecer demais a tua presença aqui conosco e toda a parceria que tu tem junto com a Safety for Me. Cassi, muito obrigada. Eu
Eu
vou
que
passar a
agradeço.
palavra para o Salvador, que vai dar sequência aqui para no nosso evento de hoje.
Preciso deixar o meu registro também de agradecimento à Cassi, porque, como ela mesmo disse, o caminho não é simples, né? E eles nos compraram a ideia, né? A Cassi comprou, o Bagatini comprou, o Dr. Ricardo Gutierrez comprou, enfim, toda a direção, alta liderança do Ernesto Dornelles acreditou nesse projeto, né? Não é à toa que tem serviço de gerenciamento de risco desde 2001, né? Então, ó, não podíamos abrir esse evento se não fosse com vocês, Cássio. Muito, muito obrigado, tá bom?
A gente
Uma
que
aleg...
agradece.
Obrigado, querido. E é uma alegria a gente dar continuidade e poder fazer a conexão para a nossa comunidade brasileira com alguns colegas que são muito importantes internacionalmente neste movimento, que ele não é do Brasil, ele não é dos Estados Unidos, ele é um movimento global. A gente sabe que hoje segurança do paciente é um problema em todo o mundo, né? E eu estou tendo a oportunidade aqui, morando aqui na Califórnia, nos Estados Unidos, de estar mais próximo de algumas pessoas que são realmente muito dedicadas, dedicam toda a sua vida a tentar fazer com que a segurança do paciente melhore, né? E é um privilégio para mim, conheci ela alguns anos atrás, quase 3 anos atrás, a Ariana Longley, que é diretora de operações da Patient Safety Movement Foundation. A Ariana se formou na Loyola Marymount University, com um bacharelado em ciências, e obteve o seu mestrado em saúde pública pela Universidade de Edimburgo, na Escócia. A Ariana ingressou na Patient Safety Movement Foundation em 2015 e se dedica a melhorar a segurança do paciente globalmente. Atualmente, o seu maior foco é na conscientização pública sobre segurança dos pacientes e os eventos adversos. Ariana, muito obrigado pela tua participação e eu passo a palavra para ti.
Thank you, Dr. Neto. Thank you so much to you and everyone at Safety for Me for inviting me to participate today. And I want to say happy Patient Safety Week. World Patient Safety Day is coming up. So have some orange flags to have the orange color, the official color of patient safety with us. So let me share my screen here and just confirm you all can see it okay. Can I get some verification that you can see okay?
Yes, it's
Okay.
Okay.
Great, thank you. So as Dr. Neto mentioned, today I'd like to speak about zero harm, our vision of zero preventable patient deaths across the world by 2030. But first I'd like to start with the problem. I know many of you are hospital administrators or work on the front lines in hospitals, but some of you may not have all of this background. So what I wanted to share with you is the problem that we're all trying to solve here, right? Is that millions and millions of people are dying every single year due to preventable medical error. In the United States, there's been multiple articles saying that this is somewhere between 200 and 440,000 Americans that are dying preventably. And I heard, I believe Dr. Neto say earlier that there's been some studies in Brazil and it's maybe the same numbers. And, you know, one of the things Dr. Neto also said was that it's about 4.8 million patients die across the world. That number has been revised a little bit. So just being transparent, that number is now estimated to be about 3 million patients across the world are affected by unsafe care and die due to that. However, we know that number is just based on studies. We don't have a way of gathering all that information from every country across the world. So take it with a grain of salt, right? We don't know the true burden of medical error and these issues with patient safety. One thing I wanted to share with you is that the public is mostly unaware of patient safety and of patient injuries and medical error. The Patient Safety Movement Foundation put out a poll last year and this year. So you'll see the lighter orange color is the data from last year and the data from this year is the more brighter orange. And what we heard was that 87.3% of the people who responded to our poll had heard little or nothing about medical error or patient injuries in the last year where they lived. And as you can see on the right-hand side, there's a few different flags. So While we're an organization that's based in the United States, we very much are looking to improve patient safety globally. And we wanted to know, at least for those people who spoke English, since it's oftentimes very expensive to translate these surveys and polls, we went to Australia and UK, South Africa, the Philippines, and the United States, and asked these questions about the public's perception of medical error. And so this summates all five of those countries that we have a huge problem. That's a huge majority of the public doesn't know a lot about patient safety and doesn't know that they perhaps need to advocate for themselves and for others. So one other piece that I want to look at is the economic impact of medical error. So it's very much about the human lives that are lost due to medical error, but this also creates waste and inefficiencies in our healthcare systems across the world. So I have some data on the United States, but knowing that you all are in Brazil, I'd like to share that second point, that globally, it's estimated that 15% of hospital expenditures and activity, this is based on data from the OECD, that OECD countries were able to see about 15% of their expenditures wasted on treating safety failures. That is a lot of money. If you look at Brazil and imagine just 15% of all of the costs in your country, essentially just treating failures due to safety, we can do better. And this isn't a new problem. You know, we look back, if we're looking historically, there's been analyses of medical error in the literature published from the 1960s, but it really wasn't until the 1990s that the patient safety movement began. The man in the top right that you see is Lucien Leap, and he was one of the fathers and pioneers who really started talking about and publishing information about medical error and patient safety issues. And, you know, he basically talked about, you know, this is three jumbo jets crashing every 2 days. And this is something that we all have to talk about. And I will also say that Marty Hatley, who will be speaking after me, he's one of the early pioneers in patient safety as well, working on this since the very early 1990s as well. So, moving on from kind of this history, there were three major pieces that came out spotlighting patient safety. One is very, very well known, which is the Two Errors Human Report that was published in 1999. And it estimated, again, based on US data, that between 44 and 98,000 patients die every year in the US based on 1999 data. And that focused on kind of errors of commission. So those were errors of commission that they mainly focused on. The second report came out 2 years after, and that was called Crossing the Quality Chasm. And the main gist of that article, that publication, was that healthcare should be safe, effective, patient-centered, timely, efficient, and equitable. And I'm sure that most everyone on this call, we would say, of course, every single one of those things is very important. So that really helped to highlight some of the ways that we knew that we needed to fix the healthcare system to focus on patient safety. And lastly was a publication in 2004, Patient Safety, Achieving a New Standard for Care. And this was not only errors of omission and commission, not just errors of commission, it was errors of omission, communication, and context are just as deadly as errors of commission. So, you know, I look at the past two decades, right? So we had a really dedicated effort. There were a lot of great organizations who stepped up and tried to do a lot around patient safety. I won't go into every single word on this page in the interest of time, but there were many, many organizations and campaigns that stepped up and said, let's try to do something about it. But where we are today is, why haven't we fixed this yet? You know, as Cassiana said, it's not easy. Anyone who says it's easy is lying, right? It's a very hard, complicated, complex system that we have to try to work on together. And so I've just highlighted 10 things. This isn't absolutely comprehensive, but it's 10 main things that have been issues that are very hard to overcome. And so the first is that improvement has been implemented in silos. You have different groups all working within their silo and not crossing over. Second is we have focused on process change more than culture change. Also, what Kasiana said, we have to focus first on the culture to protect patients. And so really focusing on that culture change is really important for you all to think about who are working in hospitals. How can you continue to improve your culture? Third, related to the second, is we blame people for making mistakes rather than examining the system processes. We know that our healthcare workers don't go to work every day to harm people. They don't want to do that. They are trying to heal and make people better and let them go home safely. So we have to move from blaming individual people and to examining the healthcare system and work on human factors and system engineering. Number four is the frontline is often afraid to speak up. It's very hard for our healthcare workers to speak up. And I know that this is a global issue. This is not just something affecting the hospitals in the country that I work in. I know that this affects you all in Brazil and many, many, many other countries across the world. Number five is care is generally clinician-centered rather than patient-centered. And we need to change that. Number six, the care environment has become extremely complex. We know that it's become so complex, so many new technologies and machines and all sorts of different complications. So how do we make the environment a little bit more simple and at least have different systems talking to one another? Number seven, care coordination is lacking across the continuum. And when I say the continuum, that's from any point of care across a patient's journey to becoming better. Number eight, sustainability is much harder than anyone realized. So saying, oh, I have a goal and I want to get to zero infections. Sustaining that is so much harder than it seems to be when you start out on a project. Number nine, most healthcare organizations are struggling financially, especially now because of COVID-19. We understand it's very difficult to have hospitals make money and that affects what they want to prioritize in order to make revenue. And number 10, culture change is very hard and takes a long time. We cannot hit home enough that culture change is so hard but so instrumental. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about who we are at the Patient Safety Movement, who I'm representing today. We have this very bold vision of zero preventable patient harm and death across the globe by 2030. We had a goal back when we started in 2012 to achieve this by 2020, and we missed that. However, when we missed it, we asked all of our advisors, our board, what do we do? Do we set another goal with a date? And they said, yes, because our mission is to urgently unify people and collectively improve patient safety across the globe. And we heard that that date really, really set us apart. It made people think, we really have to do something today, not in 2049, not in 2065. We have to do something today for our patients, because one preventable patient death, one harm is too many. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time on root causes of error. I know I'm about halfway through my time. There we go. So the first thing that I want to talk about is the lack of safety data transparency. And so, at the Patient Safety Movement, we've tried to distill down into three major buckets. If we tried to address these issues, could it get us closer to zero in the US and globally? And so one major problem is the current data estimates. They're only estimates, as I mentioned at the beginning. Is it 3 million? Is it 4.8 million? Is it 10 million? We don't know. And that is a huge problem. There's a famous quote from Peter Drucker that's, you can't improve what you don't measure. You can only improve what you measure. And so we have to know a little bit more about this data. And so, I urge you to think about how in Brazil or wherever you're listening in from, how can we improve the safety data collection and how it's reported? There's also no requirement to report all medical errors or to list medical errors as a primary or secondary cause of death on death certificates. So we're trying to work through that here at the Patient Safety Movement. How do we perhaps use death certificates to our benefit? Are there ways that we might be able to ratify or work on that? Third, organizations and clinicians are often fearful to be open and honest about errors due to fear of litigation, blame, or reputational damage, right? So they are afraid of being transparent. And what I've heard from not being a clinician, right, but working in patient safety for the last 6 years or so, is that it's so hard for these individuals to even be transparent within their own organization, not even being transparent outside of their four walls and being transparent to their patients or to a state or to a country. Even within a health system, it's very, very difficult. And again, to hit home, we have to focus on preventing system failures instead of blaming individuals. The second is misaligned incentives. I'll frame this in another way. Payment reform. How do we ensure that there's financial incentives across the board in order to improve patient safety? In the US, there are no measures through, you know, CMS, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, the closest thing that we have to a national health service for that population. There isn't anything in value-based care that pertains to patient safety. We have quality measures, but we don't have patient safety measures. We know that healthcare remains very clinician-centered rather than patient-centered, and that misaligns incentives. It's very disease focused rather than prevention focused. So if we move some of the focus to the front end of prevention rather than just treating disease, that can also help to align incentives. Organizations are often rewarded by the number of procedures that they complete and the patients that they care for rather than those patient safety and quality outcomes that I referred to. And so we really have to align financial incentives with the needs of the patients. And we really need to make it easy for organizations and clinicians to do the right thing. And last but not least, I do want to mention the lack of oversight, regulatory oversight based on region. And so we say this since we're an international organization. We know that every country is going to be a little bit different. But here in the United States and in aviation in general, there's so much more regulatory oversight. Here in the States, we have a Federal Aviation Administration that is able to enforce if something goes wrong. And then we have a National Transportation Safety Board that is able to investigate root causes and shares that information publicly. We don't have anything like that in healthcare. And as far as I know from my research, I don't believe Brazil has that. The only two countries that I'm aware of that has something like this is in Norway and in England. And so we want to try to start emulating that across the world. How can we ensure that when something goes wrong, there are at least a select number of investigations, as well as then enforcement to ensure that that doesn't happen again? And so we want to get policymakers involved and in order to improve this regulatory oversight. I know I only have a few minutes left, so I might skip over a few slides here. But, you know, we look at every healthcare organization needing to become as safe and highly reliable as other high-risk industries, like I mentioned, aviation or nuclear power and oil. And high reliability organizations are those who go for long periods of time without an adverse event. Now, the Patient Safety Movement Foundation over the last 8 or 9 years focused on some of those process changes, right? So if you look at the head of a patient, delirium or pain management, you look at the body, you know, safe surgery or infections. But what we are starting to really push forward for all the healthcare administrators and frontline is that without a foundation for safe and reliable care, these three things at the bottom, you will never be successful in these population-specific improvements. So we're really trying to drive home that these hospitals and healthcare organizations that you work for should focus on a person-centered culture of safety, a holistic continuous improvement framework. This is what I heard someone else say before, always looking at a learning culture, learning from mistakes and moving forward. And then the effective model for sustainment, right? It's really easy to start something and get really good metrics, but then to sustain it, to keep it going. So the Patient Safety Movement Foundation focuses on three main things. We forge global relationships and partnerships. So anyone on the call today, we invite you to come join us on this vision of reaching zero. Second is we develop and disseminate patient safety education. We do it for everyone, right? We have all sorts of different resources for the public, for patients and families, and for hospital administrators and frontline clinicians. So we have all sorts of education that you can consume. And then creating public demand. You think back to that poll that I showed you at the beginning, we need to let the public know in a very coordinated manner that healthcare is not as safe as they might think, and there are ways for them to be empowered patients to step up and ensure that they receive safe care, not to scare them and make them think, oh my gosh, I should never go to a hospital. We want them to still go to hospitals and go see their practitioners in order to seek care, but we want them to do it in a responsible way where they know that they are a partner. And I'm sure that Marty will talk about that when he's talking about person and family engagement. So in the interest of time, I'm going to move through this very fast. We do have lots of information on our website, but we work with everyone in healthcare, right? So anyone can partner with us, any organization, and you can commit to zero if you're a hospital. That's what we ask individual hospitals to do. Commit to zero. Tell us what you're doing to try to create a foundation for safe and reliable care. One thing I'll mention is that we are recognizing hospitals who will share patient safety data, and we will give you a badge, a ribbon, a banner, so that you can celebrate, we can celebrate you, and you can share that you are sharing data in order to be responsible. As I mentioned, we have all sorts of tools. We have our actionable patient safety solutions. We call them APSS, A-P-S-S, and these address 50 of the most common patient safety issues. This includes the actual, you know, paper versions, digital versions. We have education as well as coaching. And then we have tools and resources, not only for people in healthcare, but also patients and families, checklists and guides and webinars, even for the public to help them become educated. And lastly, creating public demand, right? So we believe every healthcare organization should be highly reliable. We want to educate and empower the public and also work on public policy. So ensure that the public can reach out to their elected officials if they've been harmed, if they want to demand safe. Siri's talking to me. So increasing that public policy work to make sure that we reach out to those legislators, to those elected officials who can make a difference. So I'll end in the next minute or so talking about World Patient Safety Day coming up on September 17th. Last year, we had a wonderful program that featured Bill Clinton, former president, Dr. Ted Ross from the WHO, many other amazing speakers. We had 9,000 people view that program in the first 24 hours. And since then, we've snipped it up into little bits and pieces and had 125,000 plus views on YouTube. And 74 countries participated in the Unite for Safe Care campaign last year. We also had several ways of activating and doing all sorts of public demonstrations. You can see here at the Capitol on the right-hand side, we had a memorial. We'll be repeating the same thing on September 17th this year. And on the left-hand side here in California, we went to the beach and did a small memorial as well. So one other last thing, just so if you don't have anything else planned for World Patient Safety Day, we do have a wonderful event planned. Dr. Ted Ross from the WHO will be back. Jeremy Hunt, who used to be the Secretary of Health of the UK. And very interestingly enough, I don't know if this made it to Brazil, but there's a show called Dr. Death with some famous celebrities. They'll be joining us and sharing what they learned as they were actors and writers for the show, what they learned participating in that. So I've left the link at the bottom in yellow in case you're interested in RSVPing. We are providing CMEs for medical education, CNEs for nursing, CPEs for pharmacy, as well as patient advocacy, continuing education. So this is a free event. If you'd like to share it with anyone outside of this group, please feel free. And with that, I think I am at time. So please just consider what you can do personally. What can you do as an individual? What can you do on behalf of your organization to push forward and really focus on zero preventable harm and zero death? So thank you very much for your time, and I will stop sharing my screen.
Ariana, é sempre um privilégio te ouvir falar. O trabalho que vocês desenvolvem realmente na Fundação Movimento de Segurança do Paciente, ele é fantástico e uma pena que por limitação a gente, de tempo a gente não consiga expandir, mas nós certamente teremos outras oportunidades para a gente trabalhar juntos, né? A ideia realmente aqui é expandir a nossa comunidade. E eu vou te pedir uma gentileza, eu vou convidar o Marte para fazer a apresentação dele. O Marte conversa um pouquinho com a gente, aí depois a gente troca umas questions and answers no final, aí faz um bate-papo para fazer o encerramento do primeiro dia, tá bom? Muito bem. O contato da Ariana, depois a gente pode passar mais corretamente, mas só entrando no site eles têm acesso a todas as informações e as conexões com o pessoal, tá bom? Então, tenho um privilégio agora de apresentar o nosso terceiro convidado de hoje, que é o Martin Hatley. O Martin, ele é presidente e CEO do Project Patient Care, que é uma organização sem fins lucrativos, com sede em Chicago, dedicado a usar a experiência do paciente para melhorar a assistência em saúde. Ele também atua como co-diretor do Instituto MedStar de Qualidade e Segurança, que integra estratégias de comunicações abertas e honestas, engajamento de pacientes e famílias e princípios de organização de alta confiabilidade em segurança e melhoria da qualidade. Ele tem atuado junto ao governo federal dos Estados Unidos como consultor em vários projetos, financiados pelo Medicare e pelo Medicaid, e também pela Agência Americana de Qualidade e Pesquisa em Saúde, além do Patient Center Outcomes Research Institute. Tem trabalhado para promover a transformação do sistema de saúde americano. De formação, o Hatley ele é advogado e atuou também como lobista da Associação Americana de Medicina, nos anos 80 e 90, onde coordenou o lançamento da National Patient Safety Foundation, em 1997, e atuou como seu diretor executivo e fundador. Atualmente, ele está nos conselhos de administração do grupo LeapFrog, da Patient Safety Movement Foundation, da Smart Patients, da Alliance for Integration Medication Management e da McNeil Hospital. Também atua como conselho consultivo para a Joint Commission, para o IHI, para o National Quality Forum, para o DATICS e para a Organização Mundial da Saúde. Então, a experiência do Martin também é enorme. Martin, muito obrigado por estar aqui com a gente. Seja muito bem-vindo. Estamos todos atentos à sua apresentação.
Thank you, Salvador. Can you hear me well?
Sim, hello? Estamos te ouvindo. We are hearing you very well. Thank you.
Okay. My video, I cannot turn on. It says the host has stopped it. I don't know if the host can change that.
Just a second, Marty.
Okay.
It works?
It works. I believe it works, yes. I can see myself. Can you see me? Hopefully. Okay,
yes.
Well, let's move forward. Salvador, how are we doing on time? Should I take 20 minutes or do we need to shorten time?
30 minutes. 20 minutes, Marty.
Okay, thank you very, very much. I will share my screen now. And can you see my slides?
No.
You can't. Okay. Thank you, Ariana. Okay. There we go.
Looks good.
Okay, good. Thank you. I'm going to put a timer on too, just to time myself a little to make sure I don't go over, because I know, there we go. You might hear a buzzer. So I'm very happy to talk to you today about the things that are really driving healthcare safety now. Many of them my colleague Ariana has mentioned, so I will go through those and just build on what she has said, but I'm excited to be with you today. I want to spend some time really looking also at a new foundational document that was published in May, and that is the World Health Organization's Global Patient Safety Action Plan, which is designed to really guide the entire, every nation in the world on their patient safety journey for the next 10 years. And I'm very involved in promoting that plan. I think it's a very good plan, and I hope the patient, the safety for me community also finds a role in it, because there are roles, I think, for the wonderful work you're doing. I also wanted to start with this inspirational quote from Carlos Castaneda, who I know is somewhat controversial, but I love the fact that he speaks to the work that we're doing as being more than just a job. Salvador mentioned people being dedicated to this work. We heard that from the speakers earlier today, but this is very worthy work. It's not just a job. It's something that is of service to everybody in our countries. And I believe it's of service to human rights. So I just applaud and am grateful whenever I hear wonderful stories like what we opened this program with. So what is driving healthcare safety now? Ariana mentioned these as our foundational documents in the United States. These are all now 20 years old. And she also mentioned the quality aims over on the right-hand part of the screen. That has gotten a lot of attention, I think, and it feels very built into the fabric of the work that we do in the United States, and I would say internationally. But on the left-hand side of the screen, that's where our challenge still is. And the left-hand side of the screen is looking for that alignment that Ariana talked about. And I think it's also the key to sustainability. Even when dedicated doctors and nurses and pharmacists and proactive organizations, organizations that are really leaders in patient safety, even when they do really good work, if the external culture is not aligned with that work, Ariana mentioned payment. I would also add education. We're still not training doctors and nurses in being really expert in engineering and those parts of the safety knowledge base and skill base. I would say media. We still have media that blames organizations when they report and are transparent. I would say certainly litigation. I don't know what the litigation climate is in Brazil, but it creates a lot of fear in the United States that keeps people from being transparent. So no matter how hard we try within our organizations, we have to really address the external culture as well and get that aligned to support our work with payment, with transparency, with law, with media, and with education. And that, I think, is the real challenge that we face for the next 10 years. I think that's where the really worthy work has to happen, is really that alignment piece. And that is what the World Patient Safety, the World Health Organization's Global Patient Safety Action Plan really addresses. I wanted to share a few more data points with you to add to the ones that Ariana has already shared, but this was a study published in 2018 based on 2016 data. From 137 countries looking at the global burden of disease. And for the first time in 2016, we saw that more people died in these 137 countries from unsafe care or poor quality care than from lack of access to care. And this was a shock, honestly, to the global public health community, because we've spent so much time trying to improve access to care in every country on earth. But what we've succeeded in doing is bringing more people into systems that still aren't safe. And we're now seeing that come forward in the data. So this was a very shocking study. It was published in Lancet, a British journal, and it led to the Lancet calling for a revolution in the way that we think about safety and quality, not just in the UK, but really globally. And I think it was certainly one of the things that motivated the WHO's policymaking body, the World Health Assembly, to step forward with their Global Patient Safety Action Plan. This is a US data point, but I wanted to share it because I think it's relevant in many other countries as well. We have, with our aging population, we have more and more people living at home with chronic medical conditions, and they're being taken care of by their family members. This is an unpaid workforce. In the United States, we have 40 million people that are taking care of a loved one at home. One in four of those are millennials, and about half of them say that they don't feel qualified to do the things they're being asked to do, which are essentially nursing tasks. It's changing tubes, it's managing complex medication, it's managing incontinence, it's managing dementia or mental health issues. So we have this huge group of people, and there's more risk moving into that home care environment. Ariana talked a little bit about the continuum of care. And so much of our work so far in safety has been hospital-based, but the risk is really moving out of the hospital, and we have to start equipping our patient and family caregivers at home, which is why I get excited whenever I see the app, because I think that kind of use of technology could be expanded or things like it to really support the home caregivers that are doing this incredibly worrisome work to them. And it takes a toll on their own health because they're so worried about their performance for the patient that they're caring for. Also wanted to mention this. This is another U.S. study, but it showed it's from the National Association for Healthcare Quality, which is our association of people who work in the quality field in healthcare. And they did a survey in 2019 that found that most people feel like they are not expert in the tasks that they're being asked to do in hospitals. And why is that? Because we haven't really trained them adequately. I mentioned before that our education system lags behind. So we have people who are in jobs where they feel minimally competent. And one of the things we really need to do if we're going to be successful across the board is raise that competency level and that skill level and that confidence level of the people that we're asking to do patient safety. This is a piece of information that I think goes to Ariana's poll. This is before the poll, but it was work that was done out of one of our states, Massachusetts, which has been a leader in patient safety. And it found that many people in the country don't want to hear about patient safety. They're resistant to really believing that there is as much room for improvement, as much challenge in the healthcare system as there is. And on the other side of that coin, many physicians are reluctant to talk about it. Many organizational executives are reluctant to talk about it because people are uncomfortable hearing it. So that's the nut we have to crack with raising awareness and getting beyond that resistance. We have to start having conversations with our patients and families, not only about what we're doing on patient safety, but what they need to do as our partner. One of the places I think we could start there are the patients and family members that are on our boards of governance. I mean, they are in some ways a captive audience, and your app already speaks to the people that are in the hospital, but what about the people that are on the boards of governance of their hospitals? That's a group that we could start with right away. This is a piece of work. There's a link here to IHI that really challenges board members to look at their role in ensuring that safety and quality remain a priority for their organization and is invested in, and the alignment happens at that organizational level. And what I like about it is they really looked at the journey of the patient through the eyes of the patient, not the patient-centered approach, not the provider-centered approach, but the patient-centered. And these are the six aims from that first foundational document that translates to the way we think we need to have this conversation with patients and families. They want to be safe, they want to be well, they need help navigating care, they want to be treated with respect, and they want to get the right care at the right time. So that's how we must move forward. I mentioned that new data that from 2016, published in 2018, that really shook up the world. And what it produced in 2019 was a major resolution at the World Health Assembly calling upon every nation to improve their work in safety. And we've been doing safety now for 20 years as a global priority, but we've missed all of our milestones, as Ariana mentioned. So this is really doubling down to say, what can we do differently and who has to be involved? This is just a quick summary of it, but you'll notice that the challenges continue to be that it's not prioritized, that we do not have even hand hygiene, which we've spoken about already across the board. We don't have the kind of emphasis on professional development and training that we need. And we're not spreading our lessons learned as well as we can because of that lack of transparency that Ariana and every speaker has spoken to already today, the importance of transparency. So what it did is called upon World Health Organization, WHO, to urge all member states to really focus on safety for the next 10 years. And you'll see on the right-hand side, just the things that they want us to focus on. investing resources, better spreading best practices, the culture piece, the educational piece, the use of innovative technology like the app, and of certainly patient and family engagement. As we all know, we are now facing another public health challenge, and that's COVID. And I think one of the things that I'm watching certainly is there's been an emphasis on patient safety, but last year we saw also a real emphasis on worker safety. So I think those two are coming together. This is a tragic story from the United States about a very, very good physician who was so overwhelmed that she took her own life. And it was just that burnout issue, that the way in which we need to create safe systems, not just to take care of patients and families, but also our dedicated health workers. I think these two issues are coming together, and I think that will really, really help us grow the sense of urgency that we have. This was a tragic story. There's a link to it here if you haven't seen it. Sorry about that. That's my dog. He's commenting. This is another story from the New York Times, just about a family that did not speak English, but ended up with COVID in the hospital and had to rely on technology and dedicated people in the hospital to keep the family engaged from outside of the hospital, as this woman, Grandma Rocket was her name, she was Colombian, had her end of life journey. It's another beautiful story that I think is very motivating. It shows the sense of urgency. This is an article from a liability insurance company in this country that looked at the last 20 years and said, we have made very little progress in ensuring safety across the board in any field except anesthesia. So we're seeing more and more of these reports come out saying, look, we've been working for 20 years, but we haven't solved the problem. We must do more. This is a major development that will, I think, help engage patients and families. I don't know how it's playing out in Brazil. It is an international movement, open notes, but as of April in this country, every patient is entitled to see their electronic medical record, not just some of the results, but basically all of the information that's in that record, including physician's notes and nursing notes and discharge notes, all the things that has not been readily transparent. And when patients are looking at this, I think it gives them the opportunity to partner in a more granular way. They will find mistakes. They will bring that back to the systems. I think this is a major step forward in patient and family engagement, not just at the bedside, but across the continuum of care. This is the Global Patient Safety Action Plan. This was a response to that resolution that was passed in 2019. The report was published in May of this year. And it calls upon four different sectors in society to really work on safety, on achieving the goals of the world, where we are now in the next 10 years. And those four groups of people are governments. So it calls upon governments to be addressing some of the alignment issues that we've not addressed so far, such as counting the number of people that are actually harmed, that lose their life or are harmed otherwise, so that we're not just estimating, as Ariana so well explained. Certainly healthcare facilities and services have to be part of the equation. The WHO Secretariat has to be part of the equation, the WHO. What they're going to do for the next 10 years is a report card every 2 years that shows the progress that all of these different groups are making. And then the largest group are the stakeholders. And these are pretty much everybody else, but this is where patients and families fit. We're a stakeholder in this equation. It's where educators fit. It's where the developers of apps and all of the other wonderful pieces of technology that are coming forward fit. So there's many, many roles for them to play as well. These are the seven strategies, and I'm going to quickly mention them. There's certainly a mission and goal here that are important, which is a world in which no one is harmed in healthcare and every patient receives safe and respectful care. And our goal is really to make the most progress we can make in the next 10 years, to really make this an international focus. So the strategies are, first of all, the first one is government. It's creating policies that really create that alignment that that Ariana talked about. The second is really bring engineering expertise into the way we operate our organizations to make them highly reliable. The third is to really focus on continuous learning in everything that we do so that our processes are not only safe, but continuously updated as new data, new research comes online. The fourth is patient and family engagement. What I love about the app is it really does create an opportunity for us to engage the patient and family when they're a patient, but we also need to be engaging patients and families in broader areas, in our improvement work, in the way we prioritize research, in our public advocacy. There are some doors that patients and families can open with their stories that providers just can't open. And that's where we're where I think there's some really exciting opportunities for patients and families. Healthcare worker education and support is the next strategy. Number six is all of the innovation that's happening in the world, whether it be in the risk sector, in the product manufacturing sector, the innovation sector, pharma, medical devices, technology applied to this work. And we have more and more data that can help inform our work in safety. We're just not using it well. So better, again, spread, better transparency, better sharing of the things that we have that can actually be predictive so that we can get in front of a sepsis or in front of a medication error and understand when it's likely to happen. And then the seventh strategy is just putting it all together and working together in partnership across different nations in the country. I want to mention two quick documents. I know we're close to time here, but the two documents here are two exciting public policy proposals that are happening in this country. And they both call upon our federal government to create new agencies that will actually do all of the coordination, all of that alignment that needs to happen. And they're both based on the aviation model because it's been so successful in our country and in many countries. One of the proposals is from the Patient Safety Movement Foundation, Ariana's organization, where I'm on the board. And that is, we're calling it the moonshot, but it's those priorities that Ariana walked us through, and we want to achieve them in a 10-year plan. It's very aligned with what the World Health Organization is doing. That's why Dr. Tedros is going to be our keynote speaker on September 17th. But it really is calling upon everyone in this country to cooperate and to really think of this as an opportunity to do something huge, a moonshot in the next 10 years. The other one to the left-hand side of the screen, and there are links to both of these, is a more modest proposal to create a body that just investigates medical errors so we can do something that really gets at the numbers of people harmed and the different ways we can use technology and information to try to improve that. I do spend most of my time on patient and family engagement, so I just want to end this with a couple of comments there. There's been a dramatic increase in research about the role of patient and family engagement in the last 10 years. This is the editor of one of our primary journals. Her name is Susan Denser, and she referred to patient and family engagement as the blockbuster drug. It's low tech, it's low cost. Patients and families are eager to help make their healthcare system safer when we talk honestly to them and engage them. And so why aren't we using it more in our healthcare system? We have to get beyond the fear of what patients will think and do it. This is a diagram that really shows, it comes out of some research that I did for our federal government that showed that when you bring patients and families into our improvement work at the organizational level, they help us do it better. And they do that when we share our data with them, when we share our challenges with them. They contribute to the purple box here, which is the operations that we've got, the staff that we've got to improve safety by giving them their point of view, how to best communicate with them, how to make many of the challenges, how to solve many of the challenges that that we face when we're doing things for patients, but not with them. So many organizations have operationalized this by building patient and family advisory councils. And we're starting to see really good data come out of that work that shows a reduction in falls, a reduction in readmissions, a reduction in pressure ulcers, those sorts of things when we bring patients and families in as our partners in designing our processes. There's a network that I helped establish at WHO in 2004 of patient champions, it's called, but it's patients and family members that want to be teamed with providers to improve safety. It's called Patients for Patient Safety. There's about 300 people who are part of this network. And part of what we can do right now around the world to really bolster and support that WHO Global Patient Safety Action Plan is become more activated ourselves as patients and families. So just last week, a group of us in the United States started an organization, a branch of that WHO network that's really going to focus on working with all the other stakeholders in this country to try to achieve those policy goals and to work as best we can as partners with provider organizations and other stakeholders. Our vision basically tracks that of the WHO's Global Patient Safety Action Plan. These are the co-founders. I'm very proud to be a member of this group. We all are seasoned patient safety advocates, and we are ready to make some noise and to be very activist in talking to our elected officials and others about prioritizing this. One of our opportunities is going to be the virtual event that Ariana has already told you about. We marched last year to that event, and we'll do it again this year. And that's where we are. I'm going to stop sharing my screen and show you that I'm prepared with my flag to go to Washington on Friday.
Just in time, Archie.
I know, 20 minutes. I timed myself, Salvador. I also want to say that on these flags, we are writing the name of somebody on the back who has been harmed. And this is the name of Josh Nahum. Salvador, I know you've met Armando. This is Armando's son who lost his life to the infection. So we're going to try to make this very personal as we plant these on the lawn of our Capitol so that people see that this could happen to anyone that they love as well.
Marty, muito obrigado pela brilhante palestra. Aliás, vocês dois são para mim grandes exemplos, né? Gente que a gente realmente tem o prazer de conviver e são, como tu dissestes ali no início da tua apresentação, motivadas por um propósito, né? Trabalham com o coração. Isso para nós é uma coisa muito, muito bacana, né? Poder compartilhar esse sentimento com toda a nossa comunidade. A Ariana já fez o convite para que as pessoas se conectem, né? E eu gostaria de pedir para a audiência, nós vamos ir construindo ao longo dos dias, das apresentações, grandes nuvens de palavras. E a gente gostaria que vocês fossem digitando no chat o que vocês vão levar de mais importante daqui para as organizações de vocês e para a vida de vocês enquanto profissionais. Enquanto nós vamos fazendo algumas perguntas aqui, um debate com a Ariana e o Martin, a gente gostaria que vocês fossem colocando as palavras mais significativas para vocês. Então, eu gostaria de começar com algumas perguntas para vocês, e aí fica aberto aos dois de poderem comentar e nos ajudar, certo? Uma das questões que nós temos percebido na nossa caminhada no Brasil tem sido a dificuldade que os profissionais da saúde têm de trabalhar em equipe verdadeiramente, né? Nós percebemos uma fragilidade na formação do profissional da saúde, sendo ele médico, enfermeiro, farmacêutico, seja qual for a sua profissão, ele acaba tendo durante a faculdade uma formação muito específica, muito voltada para si mesmo, né? E muito pouco treinamento em equipe, né? Como é este cenário nos Estados Unidos? Vocês percebem que existe uma movimentação nas escolas das profissões de saúde de maneira a integrar esses alunos desde a sua formação inicial?
Well, I'll jump in, Ariana, unless you want to jump in. But we have, this is a very difficult problem for us to solve. I mean, the curriculum already, to those that are the establishment, let's just call them that, feels too full. They feel like they have to really focus on the basics of the science that providers know, and they do not spend any time really on teamwork training. They don't spend enough time on the systems of engineering approach, where you look at your systems and how they set the people at the front line up to succeed or fail. So that's, I think, a major challenge. And there's sort of nobody in charge of, no central place in charge of healthcare education in this country. So part of what we have to do is that alignment piece. There are some very, very good teamwork training materials that have come out of the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, and they've been broadly disseminated through the existing workforce. So I think many organizations have, you know, taken their already trained doctors and nurses, seen the gap, and are using those materials. Those materials are constantly being updated. They are free at the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality's website, hrq.gov. And they're being updated again right now to bring in some of the newer issues like diagnosis that we know are sort of the frontier issues in healthcare. So I'll stop there and see if Ariana wants to add anything.
Thanks, Marty. Yeah, that was pretty comprehensive. I'll just add a few more things. You know, I think it is a super global issue. I think of an example where we were working on nasogastric tube placement, and we know that auscultation isn't the right way to do things anymore. And the good news is nursing students aren't taught that way anymore. However, the problem is when they go out into the field, they have older nurses who are supervising them, And when they speak up and say, oh, I just learned in nursing school that we're not supposed to use this, they say, this is how we do it here. Come on, let's go. And they just get dismissed. And so there's so much of this cultural, behavioral, cognitive dissonance that I've heard people talk about that is a huge challenge. I will say that there is some hope. There is a lot of curricular development going on. It is challenging to stuff more in the curriculum, as Marty said. The patient safety movement is developing patient safety curriculum. We have some resources online that are free if anyone's interested in that. I know the World Health Organization is starting to revamp their patient safety curriculum. So while some of the issues will continue to live, hopefully the future generations will be able to fix that a bit. Also, one other very small thing. I know that there's an organization that is starting here in California. I believe it's UCI, University of California, Irvine, where they're developing a program where, to your point, Dr. Netto, about the interdisciplinary communication, they're building in that the nurses and the doctors and the respiratory therapists, that they're all communicating as they're all studying together to build that teamwork communication that's been missing in the past. So people are working on it, but it's still very much the pioneers. It's not everyone.
Salvador, I'd like to add one more thing. The key to teamwork is communication. And part of communication is listening. So I think there are these listening and also speaking truth to authority, knowing when to speak up, when to be transparent, when to offer something that you know has a safety piece. So there's work happening in that communication field that will feed into the teamwork training as well.
Maravilha, muito obrigado, gente. Tem uma outra questão que apareceu na fala dos dois, na fala da Ariana e na fala do Marte, que é a questão do incentivo, da questão do desalinhamento dos incentivos, né? Nós temos percebido no Brasil um movimento bastante importante das operadoras de plano de saúde, os seguros de saúde, se envolverem no engajamento do paciente e cobrarem mais fortemente que os hospitais e as clínicas desenvolvam ações ligadas à segurança do paciente. Inclusive aqui na nossa audiência, talvez mais da metade da nossa audiência esteja ligada aos hospitais, e a outra metade da nossa audiência está conectada às operadoras de plano de saúde, né? Vocês veem isso como uma estratégia interessante de engajamento do paciente?
I would say absolutely. I'm envious hearing about it. I think we have many hospitals that have engaged patients and families, but we have not seen that happen at the health plan or the insurance level. We've seen it happen in research, but not as much as it should. So we're still climbing that, but I'd love to learn more about how you achieve that as a society in Brazil. I think many countries could learn from that if you think that is going well. Health plans, the insurance companies, that's been one of our tougher audiences to reach.
Marty, you said pretty much exactly what I would have said. It's been a tough nut to crack. During this presentation, I got an email from a family member of a patient who died. And he said, the insurance company paid $2 million out to the hospital, that it was a sentinel event that killed his wife. And they got $2 million from that. So we would absolutely love to understand how to engage healthcare insurance plans, employers, to not have this kind of payment go out when a sentinel event, a never event, has happened.
Salvador, Ariana has mentioned the educational work that the Patient Safety Movement Foundation does, and they are fantastic programs. You've been on some of them. And I think if there's a team that we could, from Brazil, Ariana, I hope you don't mind me bringing this up. I am on the education committee, but if there's a team from Brazil that we could really highlight to show others, because it is an international audience for these webinar events that PSMF does.
Vamos trabalhar nisso, Mati. Temos esse compromisso com a segurança do paciente globalmente. Se a gente puder ajudar, certamente estaremos à disposição aí. Nós vamos apresentar ao longo dos dias da semana, se vocês tiverem a oportunidade de ver, alguns cases das operadoras do Brasil que estão conectando não só os indicadores de segurança do paciente, mas a percepção deles em programas de bonificação e remuneração. Então, o engajamento tem partido diretamente da operadora e, de uma certa forma, pressionando um pouco os prestadores a desenvolver. Mas depois, no momento apropriado, podemos conversar um pouquinho mais sobre isso também. Aproveito já para fazer um gancho de uma outra pergunta que me chegou aqui, que é a seguinte. Engajar o paciente, sabemos que é um grande desafio. Às vezes, o paciente nem quer saber muito sobre esses problemas relacionados à segurança, ele quer deixar isso na mão dos colaboradores, às vezes eles têm medo de saber, enfim, existem vários fatores, às vezes eles não têm nem capacidade intelectual de entender muito, a gente tem um desafio de comunicação, Martin, de novo, né? Um desafio de comunicação com o paciente. Isso tem sido a nossa rotina de trabalho na Safety for Me, né? A gente tem a grande dificuldade de realmente engajar verdadeiramente o paciente, né? E sei que ambos, tanto a Ariana quanto o Martin, têm muita experiência em várias estratégias, né? Tipo, se faz webinar, se faz apresentação, se conversa, se desenvolve materiais, né? Na experiência, na vida de vocês, tem alguma estratégia que vocês imaginam que funciona um pouco melhor, que teve um nível de engajamento dos pacientes um pouco maior?
Ariana, do you want to go first or should I jump in? Okay. I think technology is going to be a big aid. When you think about the big companies like Apple or Microsoft that are trying to figure out how to better engage patients and or people on non-healthcare topics, they're creating the pathways. They're making our devices easier to use. They're gaming the way you are. I mean, your use of that approach, I think, has great potential. And I think we're at the beginning of that. Journey. So everyone, not everyone, but many, many people now have access to a smartphone. If we can do more things with the smartphone, more people, even things like reminders of appointments or reminders about medications, those sorts of things, or apps that support them. Your app is wonderful. There's another app called Patient Aider that we use. So I think that is a strategy that we haven't utilized enough. I also mentioned, and that has great potential, I also mentioned that open notes, once we give people access, are transparent with their electronic health records. I actually find an error in my electronic health record every time I check it out. And it's usually a dosing of medication for me. That's usually the one that I find the most, but just the lag time. And if we can create communication better through that electronic portal that the open notes movement is pushing globally, I think that could be another game changer.
I totally agree with you, Marty. I think that technology has a huge role to play. Another idea of just a strategy is just talking about it, you know, having people share their stories, whether it's instances of harm or whether it's a tragedy where someone's lost their life. You know, I think about when, you know, I meet new people, which fortunately has been happening more frequently these days, but when you talk to someone and you mention patient safety, usually it goes straight over their head, right? But when you start talking about the examples of infections, you talk about examples of medication errors or communication issues, almost every time someone has some kind of story to share, they say, oh, my aunt, she went in for hip surgery and she got a surgical site infection, or someone will remember it. And so I think there's also this importance of storytelling to bring it back to the humanness of it all, that we are all going to be patients if we haven't already been at some point in our lives. So this is not something that we're immune to. You know, the chance that it's going to affect you or someone directly connected to you that you love is highly, highly likely that they're going to engage in healthcare and could benefit from being more engaged as a patient. So I think just talking about it, you know, really can help.
Salvador, one more idea I've got. This comes out of some of the research I've done with the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, but they're looking at the people with low health literacy or who do not speak English in our country as their first language. And they're trying to make some tools that are very simple and not technological. And it's interesting that research has been formed because there were patients and families that were advisors at the front end. To give you just one example to address the issue of diagnosis, because we know that's an emerging problem. We have two tools that are just going to be published this week, I think. One of which is a tool for patients or families to use, and it just asks them to write down the three things that are the most important things for them when they go to the doctor, because often a patient is nervous or in pain and they don't remember when they're sitting there with the doctor. The doctor side of the tool or the nurse side of the tool is not to interrupt the patient for an entire meeting. Research shows that a doctor will typically interrupt a patient who's talking after 14 seconds. So we're asking them to wait 1 minute before they say anything, just because patients have because they're nervous, sometimes have a hard time gearing up to really get out of their mouths what they are really concerned about. So there can be some very simple tools like that too that are based on bringing that patient perspective into the research. I can share those tools. They've been very well tested and shown great success in the places where they've been piloted.
Muito bom. A ideia realmente aqui, né, Martin, é a gente poder compartilhar as melhores práticas. Muito, muito obrigado. Nosso compromisso com o horário, né, nós nos comprometemos a iniciar a 13h, horário brasileiro, e terminar às 14h30. Eu não tenho palavras para expressar toda a gratidão que a gente tem. A gente não poderia ter começado esse evento de melhor maneira, né, com a Cassiana apresentando o nosso maior parceiro, com a Ariana e o Martin, com toda essa bagagem que vocês têm. A gente realmente fica muito feliz, muito obrigado pela oportunidade. Eu gostaria de abrir um espaço para vocês deixar alguma consideração final para a gente poder encerrar a nossa sessão de hoje.
I'll just chime in real quick. Thank you so much, Dr. Netto's safety for me for inviting us to participate today. I just want to remind all of you, no matter what your role is, you can make a difference. You can improve patient safety, even if it's a little bit, or even if it's a lot, you can do something. So I just encourage you to, you know, think about what Cassiana said, what Marty said, what I said, what Dr. Netto has said, what Caroline has said, and think about what can you do and take little baby steps to get there. So thank you very much. And I wish you all the best with the rest of your events this week, and boa tarde.
I also want to express gratitude. I learned a lot from Cassiana's presentation. It was nice to meet her virtually and to be excited by the things that she's accomplishing there. I love the fact that you're actually measuring with the Net Promoter Score. What you do there. I can't think of a hospital that's that transparent with patients in the United States that's doing that. So we have to keep spreading. We have to keep sharing and spreading amongst our countries. That is the whole tone of the Global Patient Safety Action Plan, is that we're going to spread and share more. And we can do that by starting to wear orange. I'm going to now wear orange for the rest of the week because that is the WHO patient safety color. So let's just do that as a first step and commit to sharing what we learn. If we have anything that you want to learn about how to engage patients, I'm happy to share more tools there.
Muito obrigado a todos os nossos painelistas de hoje. Agradecer essa fantástica audiência que nós estamos tendo. Dizer para vocês que esse material, depois, a posteriori, vai ser publicado na YouTube, nos canais pertinentes, né? E deixar o convite aqui para todos vocês que amanhã, à 13h, horário brasileiro, teremos a nossa segunda sessão. Iniciaremos com o case do Hospital da Unimed Nordeste, e depois, na sequência, teremos a apresentação, um debate sobre ciência da melhoria com a doutora Elenara Ribas e o doutor Antônio Capone, do IHI. Muito obrigado a todos e uma boa semana para vocês.